Good morning. Welcome to our service today. Trust that that's your heart's desire. Come into the house, into his house to worship him this morning. Let's begin our service, please, by standing, singing Wonderful Grace of Jesus, and then please remain standing for prayer.
Good to be in the house of God today. If you could turn, if you want to follow along, I'm going to read our few verses in 2 Timothy. It's the last four verses of 2 Timothy, chapter 4, verse 19. And it says, "Salute Prisca and Aquila, in the household of Onesiphorus. Erastus abode at Corinth, but Trophimus have I left at Miletus sick. Do thy diligence to come before winter. Eubulus greeteth thee, and Pudens, and Linus, and Claudia, and all the brethren. The Lord Jesus Christ be with thy spirit. Grace be with you. Amen." Let's look to God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, just want to bow before you this morning, with excitement, with reverence. We thank you for the God that you are, the God of truth. We thank you for your word that inspires us, that challenges us, that's true, that unchangeable, God. We thank you for your faithfulness to us and just your almighty power, God. We just want to worship you today with full hearts, God, and just challenge us to hear the message today, but more importantly, live it out this week as we meet our unsaved relatives, unsaved friends, unsaved coworkers, that we could be a light in this world. God, that's my prayer for all of us and myself included, that we'll just be challenged to see people in the eyes of eternity, that we can make a difference for the kingdom of Christ. God, we just have a request to lift up to you. We think of little Mava that's had surgery this morning in the accident at the park, that God just heal her arm, and the surgery that's gone on, just be with her and her family as she recovers from this. We think of a situation with Sandy Steiner that going through surgery, that was emergency. Just be with the doctors and be with her as she recovers and receives the treatment, God. But thank you for the good report from the teen mission trip, God. Thank you for safety and the looking forward to hearing from how it impacted our youth group. And thank you for the leaders and volunteers that saw that through. God, we just want to honor you this morning, honor you with our lives this week, challenge us to be strong Christians, and just to live out our faith this week as we go through the world. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Please be seated.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's good to be back with cornfields and soybeans. I did not see much of that, although there was a little bit in Wisconsin. No, seriously though, thank you for all your prayers on the trip. It was truly wonderful and beyond my wildest dreams of what God could do. So your prayers were greatly appreciated. While I'm giving announcements, if Kit and Allison could join us up front, I'd love to have them speak about their experience in a minute. But before we talk about the trip, I want to let you know about a few things that are going on in the church here soon. Today at 1:30, Olivia Griggs has a bridal shower. I was told to let you know that lunch is provided, so you don't have to worry about food. So join us for that. This Tuesday, 11:30, is the Generations Fellowship. And there has been a change from the bulletin. I guess it's at Genera Park. So if you're wanting to join us, please join us for that. Next Sunday at 1 p.m. is a baby shower for Morgan Witherill. And see Katie Cheney today if you have a contribution to the group gift for that. Next Sunday, 4:30, is supposed to be the Sunday Fellowship at the Stewart's. I guess there's pond fun, games, meat, and drinks provided. So if they're asking if you could bring a dish to share, please do that. I have been to their house one time, and it's a beautiful place. We're going to have a great time, so looking forward to that. And I want to now at this time transition to having our teens come up. Kit, would you speak first?
I'll just try to keep this underneath an hour. So the thing that I learned or kind of stuck with me the whole entire week was that God could come and use pretty much anybody to fulfill his purpose. And then the funnest thing was doing the sit-up competition with a 25-pound weight on your chest, which took a lot longer to do 50 than I expected. And then lastly, I'd like to thank all the people who walked behind the scenes to help us go to Wisconsin to have such a fun trip.
Thanks. Thank you, Kid.
So I think that this trip was really amazing, and I'm really, really glad that I got to go. It was a lot of fun to be with my youth group for that long. We got to know each other really, really well. I think it was kind of funny because our numbers were flip-flopped from our last mission trip that we went on. Last year it was only 4 girls and then the rest of us were guys, and this year it was only 4 guys and the rest of us were girls. So that was really funny. I think the funnest moment was probably, for me, I got to learn how to use a weed whacker, and I don't know why, that was really fun. So, the thing that stuck with me the most was we learned a lot about who God was throughout the scriptures and our devotionals that we did, and I think those devotionals were really well put together and a lot of fun to do. And I just want to thank all of the volunteers and Pastor Cameron for putting this together. It was really fun, and I'm really glad that we all got to go.
Well, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. I'm going to do my best to keep my contribution brief, Pastor Jerry. I don't want to rain on your parade, but the boys did this thing in the cabin where we said, okay, what's your best moment of the day, your hardest moment, and then the most interesting. So I think that's a good format to kind of navigate my experience of the week. My worst experience of the trip, or hardest, looking at you, Skylar, you were there for this one. We were working on a bike trail, and the gentleman that was leading the project named Ben asked us to move this very large stone to get out of the way. And so we lifted up this stone, and I feel this very sharp, hot pain in my back. I thought I threw my back out, and I'm sitting here contemplating, what do I do? And then I felt another on my elbow, and then I see the bees. And I looked like I was on fire. I was running, ah! I had my hat, and I was waving around, and I heard a little bit of laughter, but Skylar also got stung. I think it was once. I don't know where you're at, Skylar, but oh, there he is. Yeah, so he's able to relate. It was hard. Let's put it that way. Very, very hard. My most interesting moment of the week, I think it had to have been my conversation with Ben, just about the ministry they do there. It's really fascinating. Obviously, they contribute so much to the boarding school ministry, but they do so much in outreach, too, by using their facilities to honor the Lord, and just how creative they were in using everything God's given to them. That ministry is really fascinating, and just so you know, it's called the Victory Academy for Boys, a boarding school rescue ministry. Very, very cool niche thing they're doing to bring glory to God, and I think, if anything, young men are a target audience for this demonic and satanic work that's going on in our culture. It's so great to see they're contributing to raising up young men. And so I thought that was just really great. And I think my best moment of the entire trip is hard to encapsulate just one moment, but there are just so many different times where I saw the young people from our church bonding, growing in the Lord, being further equipped, and seeing unity like Christ wants to have unity, you know. Obviously, there are people who know each other better, and there are groups, right? But there was never this click thing. There was always interaction with everybody, and I love to see that. That was so good and humbling for me to see. So that's what I wanted to say today. In short, way beyond any of my expectations, and praise the Lord that he kept us. It was a very long drive. I mean, long drive, but so good. So thank you so much.
At this time, if we would please stand, we'll sing our praise and worship songs together.
There is all we want found. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus. right, let's do turn in our Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 4. This is kind of like the postscript of the book. How many of you wondered when Jeremy read that a while ago, what in the world is Pastor going to do with that? If you would notice at the end of verse 18, you see the word amen. There's a period there. Could have stopped there, but again, this is the postscript. And as a matter of fact, if you love your Bible, if you study the Bible, maybe this next information will be of benefit to you. But some think that maybe possibly Luke, the physician who was with Paul this time, served as a secretary, and as Paul got it from the Lord, he gave it to Luke, and Luke wrote it down, and that's why you have the period at the end of verse 18. And some think that Paul said, could I have the pen, Luke? I'm going to write this last part myself. In other words, folks, these are the last words of a dying man. How many of you, don't raise your hands, but how many of you have ever been privileged to stand next to a loved one when they were dying and took their final breath? You know, I can raise my hand. I saw my dad for the last time to talk with him in December of 2009. In January, I was sitting in my office, got a phone call one morning. My brother called me and said, if you want to see Dad, you better get here soon. I took the quickest flight I could out of Dayton, got in an ice storm down in North Carolina somewhere. Had to wait there most of the day, but finally got out and got to Jacksonville, rented a car, rushed, and I was with my dad. About 2 o'clock that night, he took his final breath. I was the only one in the room besides the nurse who came running in when the bells and whistles started going off. But to this day, I had hoped that my dad could take that air mask off and say something to me. That never happened. But I'll guarantee you this, if my dad had said something to me in that moment, I would have never forgotten it. Because when you take your final breath, those words that you're saying, your last words, are extremely important. And that's why we just can't skip over that. There's something here. I think, if you're asking me, the most valuable things in the world are right here. And I want to unpack them for you this morning. I read this week about a man, this eccentric millionaire, who had everything this world had to offer. But he had so much money, he didn't know what to do with it. Can you imagine being in that position? And one of the things he did is he bought this treasure chest, and he stuffed it with millions of dollars, and he put it somewhere in the Colorado Rocky Mountains. And then he would send out clues. And they say, estimated that 350,000 people, over 350,000 people, that's what got me, started searching for the valuable treasure. That people quit their jobs, that people withdrew their savings account to go search for the millions of dollars in that treasure chest. And get this, they estimate 4 people lost their lives in the process. And finally, one man from the East Coast who wanted to remain anonymous found the hidden treasure and took a photograph of it to put to rest. Everyone thought it was a hoax after a while. No one was finding it. But think about that for just a moment. So what if you get a treasure chest that's stuffed with millions of dollars and you don't have what Paul writes about in these verses? What I hope you'll see in this passage this morning is these are the eternal things that are really important. And if they're that important, I don't know what else you're chasing in life, you better consider this, because this is what's most important right here. I want to give you 3 things that are extremely valuable. I feel like praying again. Father, thank you for your word. As we've been digging through 1 and 2 Timothy, it's just really enriched my heart to see in the first book of Timothy how you were interested in a church like this church, making sure they have godly leaders in place. And we're coming up into that season of the year where we're going to have to think through who our leaders are going to be for this church. So help us in that area, Lord, I pray. I thank you for our current elders. I thank you for our current deacons. I thank you for our current deaconesses and our trustees and so many in our Sunday school program and KYB that without this wonderful, precious army, work could not get done here in Arlington, Ohio. But then I'm reminded of the second book of Timothy where you put the leadership on notice that there were ravenous wolves just ready to come into the church and destroy the local congregation, the local sheep. And so, Father, we pray that the study of 1 and 2 Timothy have not been in vain, that we will continue to look to you for guidance and wisdom and protection, that you'd be pleased to come along here in this little town in northwest Ohio and do such a work that folks would have to sit up and pay attention that there's still a God who lives in heaven. And we are all heading toward the judgment seat of Christ, where if we know him in salvation, we must give an account of our lives. If we don't know him in salvation, then that means after the millennial rule and reign of Christ, we'll have to stand before him and hear the words, "Depart from me, ye that work iniquity, I never knew you." So please speak to our hearts through your word and through your servant, Paul, by your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, let me jump into this. These are the things that are the most valuable possessions on planet Earth. Number one would have to be your relationships with other people. Someone told me several years ago, the two most important things in life, the Bible and people, because those are the only two things that'll really last forever. Notice what Paul does here as he picks up his pen and writes this postscript. He says, I want to remember some folks that were dear, dear, dear helpers to me during my ministry. This couple, Priscilla and Aquila, are mentioned six times in the New Testament. Four of those times, as in this instance, she's mentioned first. I don't know why, so please don't ask me afterward. But I do know this, as I've been digging into their lives this week, they were a very valuable couple to the Apostle Paul. So let me give you a quick bird's eye view of all these places that are mentioned and how they came alongside the Apostle Paul and helped him in his ministry. Don't know if you can see this from where you're sitting, but the couple, Aquila and Priscilla, were kicked out of Rome around 53 AD. I believe the book of Acts says the Emperor Claudius was on the throne. And when they were kicked out of Rome, they came to a town called Corinth. Paul was there for about a year and a half in Corinth. And remember, Paul had to do a side job to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. What was his side job? He was a tent maker. And I don't know if it was his ability, his craftsmanship that attracted him to this couple or not, but I do know this. He spent a considerable amount of time with this couple, and they were also tent makers. For a year and a half, maybe they were already converted before they met Paul. Maybe Paul led them to Christ. But imagine they spent a year and a half in their house and Paul ministered together with this wonderful couple. And then as you read the book of Acts into chapter 19, they went from Corinth to Ephesus. And of course, this is the area where Timothy was the pastor. Paul was there for 3 years later on in his third missionary journey. But this couple followed Paul over to Ephesus. And they had a great revival there. In fact, the Bible says that God was pleased just to do miraculous works and signs through the Apostle Paul while they were there. And they had the big riot in town and such. But while they were there, the Bible says that this couple, Aquila and Priscilla, ministered to a young man named Apollos. And he was gung-ho preaching and teaching, but the problem is he only knew half of the story. He was preaching and teaching about the repentance of John the Baptist. He had failed to realize the rest of the story is that Jesus Christ died, was buried, rose again, and that repentance is one thing, but they need to know faith in Jesus Christ, his powerful, miraculous, saving power to save. Then this couple went over to Corinth. They had a house church in their house there. And then evidently when Nero rose up around 64, they went back to Ephesus. And Paul picks up his pen here and he says, I want you to greet this wonderful couple, Priscilla and Aquila. Now, what is the treasure in front of us this morning that's very valuable? It's maintaining these strong relationships. Here, as he's about to die, he mentions Aquila and Priscilla, but he's not finished. He also mentions, look at your Bibles here, in verse 19, he mentions this individual whose name is Onesiphorus. I'll get to that in a moment. This reminds me, when Paul wrote the book of Romans a couple of years later, we find this is what he said about Priscilla and Aquila. He said that this couple were willing, notice, to lay down their own necks for me. That's the kind of Christians they were, unto whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. So, remembering dear helpers. The next individual that he mentions here is very interesting. He says, salute Priscilla and Aquila, but also the household of Onesiphorus. Now think about that for just a minute. Why did he mention just Onesiphorus? He mentions the entire family. Some think that Onesiphorus, as we're going to see in a moment, paid a visit to the Apostle Paul. He was fearless in doing that. And because he went over to Rome during time of extreme persecution under Nero, some think he wasn't able to leave, that he was executed. I don't know if that's true or not, but I do know this. Sometimes in ministry, there are generations of people that God sends your way, and they are extremely refreshing to the rest of us who serve in ministry. In fact, in a moment, I'm going to show you in the first chapter of this book how that Onesiphorus, the Bible describes him as being one who refreshed the Apostle Paul and one who risked his life for the sake of the Apostle Paul. How many of you have ever been in a hot situation, a desperate situation, and somebody gave you a drink of water? We were over at the Village Festival yesterday, and they converted the baseball field there into, blow-up balloons. And among other things, they had train rides, and they had horse pony rides. That's what it was. It brought back a lot of memories to me. And our grandson and granddaughter are in town, so we took them over to the pony rides. And while we're waiting to get on the pony rides, somebody brought this 5-gallon bucket of water to the ponies. And as soon as they stopped going around in circles, you know how it goes, they were giving them a refreshing drink of water. It reminded me of this passage of Scripture. How many of you in ministry have been refreshed by generations of people? There's a godly mom and dad, and they have children, and they have children, and they have children. This is a household. He says, as he's thinking over his shoulder, thinking through his life, want you to greet Priscilla and Aquila. And don't forget about the household of Onesiphorus, because he often refreshed me. And he was the one I'll never forget, came to visit me when I was in prison, when Nero was sitting on the throne, and he never made it home. That's a possibility of understanding Onesiphorus this way. That he gave his neck, his life, for the great Apostle Paul. Next, he remembers an honored treasure. Look at your Bibles in chapter 4, in verse 20. Erastus abode at Corinth. Who was Erastus? We don't know much about him. There are about 3 verses in the New Testament, so we got to, again, try to connect the dots. But he was a beloved treasurer of the city of Corinth. Think about that. Someone who had integrity. We first bump into him. He's at Ephesus, and Paul sends him with Timothy on an assignment, ultimately to Corinth. And while he's there, maybe they need someone as a treasurer for the big city of Corinth. And so they task this guy, Erastus, to do the job. And several years later, when Paul writes the book of Romans, he says, Gaius, mine hope, my host, and all the whole church salute you. Erastus is the chamberlain, which means a treasurer, a steward. You don't own it. You're just taking care of what someone else owns. Years later, this Erastus became the steward of the treasurer of the town of Corinth. And Paul wants him to be remembered as well. So he remembers some dear helpers. He remembers the entire household of Onesiphorus. He remembers an honorable treasurer like Erastus. And he remembers a very healthy companion. Notice what the word trophimus means. Nutritious. Have you ever been around someone who's nutritious spiritually. I mean, things are being sold nowadays, like breakfast bars. And what they try to sell is that little word, if you eat these, it's very nutritious for you. And there are people in my life, just hanging around them, being around them, I learned something I didn't know. Or I see an insight from God's word. I never really saw it that way. Paul had a companion named Trophimus who was nutritious. As a matter of fact, if you study the book of Acts, this Trophimus went with Paul as Paul made his way down to Jerusalem. And Paul went into the synagogue there, or went into the temple rather, and there was a little sign that said off limits to the Gentiles. You go any further than this place right here, this wall, it's off with your neck. And if you read the book of Acts carefully, it was this Trophimus that was with Paul when Paul went into the temple. And the people thought, the Jews that hated Paul thought that this Trophimus went in with him. So they accused Paul of this. And if you keep reading the book of Acts, Paul spent 4 years in prison before he went to Rome because of this character right here. Whether he went with Paul into the temple or not, we don't really know, but they said, they accused the apostle Paul that it was this guy right here that went in with him because he was Greek. Paul was thrown in prison, but God used that for his glory. But somehow or other, this Trophimus makes his way up back to Ephesus, and just south of Ephesus, there's a place called Miletus. And as Paul is using his final energy here, he can't get this guy out of his mind. He says, Trophimus, I've left at Miletus. And of all things, the nutritious guy is sick. Well, that makes you wonder, doesn't it? Why, when you read the book of Acts 19, when Paul, God is allowing the Holy Spirit to flow through him, and he can touch people and bring divine healing, people would bring their handkerchiefs and lay around for the Apostle Paul to touch, with all that power flowing and emanating through his body, why couldn't Paul just go to Miletus and heal this character himself? Why couldn't the other apostles do it? John MacArthur thinks that we're getting awfully close to the end of an era when we have the complete record of the Word of God. And the more we have of the Word of God, you see this ministry that the apostles had of healing people becoming a thing of the past. Book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 13 says, when we have that which is complete, that which is in part shall be done away with. Well, that's Trophimus. Paul said, I leave him at Miletus, and he might be triggering Timothy's thoughts, hey, it's just south of town. Why don't you go down there and see him? That's a possibility too. I do know this, as we're talking about strong relationships, that the middle name of our church is Bible Fellowship Church. I talked with an elderly person this week in Findlay who's searching for a church home. And they said, you know, I went through the scriptures and I tried to find what am I looking for when I look for a local church to attend? And they said, the first thing I look for is, do they preach the Word of God? And they based this all on the book of Acts. And it's all right there when the church was at its height. I look for a church that preaches the Word. Number two, I look for a church where there's fellowship. I look for a church where there's prayer. I look for a church where there's communion. And I thought about that as I walked away from that individual, how important fellowship is. Our middle name is fellowship. Paul points out that the first thing that was important to him as he is about to take his final breath is fellowship of the believers, maintaining strong relationships. And there was a professor at the University of California years ago that did some research. And he said, he pointed out the importance of social support systems. And he pointed to the country of Japan. He said it was the number one in the world with respect to healthy relationships due to their close social, cultural, and traditional ties. The more social the ties are, the better the health and the lower the death rate. And then he said, when it comes to isolated people, when people become more and more isolated, pull back from society, pull back from their friends, pull back from fellowshipping with others, the poorer the health and the higher the death rate. Social ties, he concluded, are good preventative medicine for physical problems and for mental and emotional behaviors. I hope you understand that one of the reasons we have the fellowship times, as was mentioned this morning in the announcements next week over at the Stewart's, last week over at the New Loves, and appreciate so much all the sacrifice that was obvious that they put into all that. And throughout the summer months, having these fellowship is so vital for a church like ours. Paul says, as he's coming to a close here, it's one of the most valuable things that you can do, get involved in the lives of other people at your local church. Paul shows us how he was maintaining strong relationships right up to the point of death. As a matter of fact, I think if you'll count through here, there are about 23 names total at the end of 2 Timothy. And Paul picks up his pen here with his postscript, and he mentions about 10 of them and all the brethren he's going to use in that little phrase in this next part here. But the next thing I noticed Paul did is he talks about maximizing your opportunities. What's the most valuable thing in the world? A treasure chest stuffed with millions of dollars? Or maintaining personal relationships? Or maximizing the opportunities that are available to you until you take your final breath. Notice how he does this. He says, Timothy, he uses the word spadazzo, which means give it all you got. Look at verse 21. Do thy diligence. That's one word in the original language, spadazzo. In fact, he's used it earlier in this book. See if I can find it. Verse 9, do you see it? Same word. Do thy diligence. Spadazzo here. Give it all you've got. Do thy diligence to do what you can while you can do it, to come before the foul weather shows up. Now think about this. We're talking about 1,000 miles away. Here's Ephesus where Timothy is pastoring. He receives a letter from the Apostle Paul who's sitting in a dungeon 1,000 miles away. And Paul is asking Timothy to come to do everything he can within his power. Come before you can't come anymore. Because the shipping lanes will be frozen over in some cases. The mountains, if you chose to go by land, are impassable during the winter months. So Timothy, I'm asking you as a friend to come before winter. Look up at verse 13, I think it is. He told him these are the things he wanted him to bring earlier. Bring my coat. It's going to get awfully cold here in this dungeon in the wintertime. And bring the books, but especially the parchments. Timothy, would you mind dropping everything? I'd love to see you. You're my dearest and best friend. I poured into you. I invested into you. And if it's possible, under the good hand of God, I'd like to see you before I die. So maximize your opportunities. What's your opportunity? Comfort others. What a comfort that would be if Timothy showed up. Paul got to see him face to face before he died. We don't know if he ever made that trip, and we don't know if he ever got to see him face to face, but that was his longing. The second thing I noticed is that Paul was sending greetings from the church at Rome back to the church at Ephesus. And I want you to notice about 5 characters in through here that make up the local church at Rome at this time. And as Paul is writing, these people in one fashion or another got to him and said, by the way, if you're talking to the church at Ephesus, please tell them I said hi. Please send the greetings my way to them from me. So notice the first person that he uses is the name Eubulus. Is that how you pronounce it? I don't know. But I do know this. In the original language, it means a practical person. Now, I got to tell you, this was very instructive for me, that the church at Rome consisted of people like this, that the church at Rome was thriving even under the persecution of Nero. And I think when God looks down on a congregation like this, he longs to see people like this in the local church, practical people. Oh, it's good to have information, and it's good to know different information backward, forward, upside down, have all kinds of memory verses committed to memory. But boy, you like people down in the trenches that do something with the information made available to them. That's the kind of guy Eubulus was. Practical. Paul is writing, and somehow Eubulus got to Paul and said, oh, you're writing to the church over there at Ephesus? Please, please tell them hi from me. As a way of spurring them on, cheering them on. Here's another one. This is what the local congregation ought to consist of. People who are practical on what they do for Jesus Christ, and people who are just ordinary. kind of like Kit got up a while ago and said that the thing God showed him this past week, that God can use anybody to accomplish his great purposes.
Man, I love that. That's very mature.
And God is still looking for ordinary people today to do his great work. Here's Linus. Ever been in a church where someone just captures your heart? They are so in love with Jesus Christ, you'll never forget them. Some of you have served at other churches, and there are people, when I mention this, they just come to your mind right away because they are very dear to you. And if I were to leave this church tomorrow, there are people here that will always be very meaningful to me because they've captured my heart, they've captured my attention. Here's another one, Claudia, lame. That's interesting. In the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 1, again, Paul talks about the kind of people that God chooses to use. Not necessarily the high and mighty, but those who are low, down and out, lame people. And he says, all the brothers at the church at Rome send their greetings. They'd like to spur you on. They'd like to cheer you on. And that's what's important when it comes time to die, that you're maximizing your opportunities. Again, I'm going to mention it, but I want to put it up here on the overhead for your sake to drive it home. It shows us that even during the reign of Nero, when intense persecution had broken out, it shows us that the church was alive and well. And the other thing it shows us is from the book of Hebrews, that the purpose of the local church, in part, is to spur other people, motivate other people on toward Jesus Christ. We're not to forsake. That literally means leave in the lurch. To get up on a Sunday morning and say, you know, should I go to church or not? I'm feeling pretty tired this morning. I think I'll just sleep in. My only opportunity of the week to sleep in. How many of us could use that excuse? The scripture says, don't abandon. Don't leave in the lurch. Coming together, as the manner of some is, but encouraging and exhorting, motivating one another, and so much more as that day is coming into crystal clear focus. We are going to have to stand before God. And I don't go down to church just to get. That's what a lot of people do. Can they entertain me today? Can I feel warm fuzzies today? But when you read the scripture, the purpose of going down to the church in large part, yes, to be fed, but it's to exhort. It's to encourage others. It's to give, if I can say it that way, not just to get. So notice, he maintains strong relationships, but he maximizes opportunities. Opportunity to comfort others. Timothy, do whatever's necessary. Drop everything. Spadazzo, get here. Comfort me. And by the way, the folks at the church here at Rome, they send you greetings. But notice, this is very interesting in verse 22, the last verse. He mentions another name. The complete name for Jesus Christ. The title, the name, and his purpose for coming into this world. Christ Jesus came to save sinners. And he says, here is your opportunity to show Timothy that you completely trust in the Lord. When God sends his Holy Spirit into your heart and your spirit mixes with the Holy Spirit, you got something powerful on your hands. You know, we're more than just the beast of the field. Mind, emotion, will, and body. An animal has that. Well, I'll tell you what distinguishes us from the animal world. It's that spirit, that inner part of me that the animal kingdom doesn't have. And this inner part of me is able to relate to God himself. Paul said, the Lord Jesus Christ be with thy spirit. What would it look like if God mixed his spirit with your spirit? If God put his spirit in your spirit, what would that look like? I was walking this week on an alley here in Arlington here and met a friend of mine who was about to take his race car to the races. And he was putting the final touches on it.
And we talked, and he said, "Hey, come, I want to show you my hobby." He opened up his trailer, and there was a modified rail car. Now, this is an actual rail car right here. My brother took me to the Gator Nationals one day in Gainesville, Florida, and we saw cars like this. They can go down a quarter-mile track in, what, just a few seconds. But the guy here in town, he has a modified short rail. And he was showing me that it takes special oil. And he was showing me that it takes special fuel oil, gasoline. And it doesn't go as quickly as these things go, but nevertheless, it lights up when you punch the gas pedal. And it made me think, what is this world looking for from a Christian? The world is looking for someone who has God's spirit in their spirit. Will it look like this according to the scriptures? Well, it may look something like that, but it probably will look more like this. Jesus said in John chapter 4, repent. And then he told the followers to follow me. I'll make you fishers of men. Then you turn the page to chapter 5 of the book of Matthew, and he says, this is what real Christianity looks like. When God sends his spirit to mix with your spirit, Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are those who mourn, they shall be comforted. And blessed are the meek, those are the ones who will inherit the earth. And blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, because they shall be called the sons of God. And if you do this, he has one more. Blessed are you when you're persecuted for righteousness. And what do you do? Gripe and grumble and complain. When his spirit mixes with your spirit, you will rejoice and be exceeding glad, because great is your reward in heaven. Because just as they're persecuting you, Jesus said that's what they did with the prophets in the Old Testament. I read a story this week about a professor from an Ivy League school who was very smart, intellectual. And he said his life changed one day when he stopped beside the road to help a lady change her flat tire. He was changing her tire when someone fell asleep at the wheel and ran into her car. And her car ran over him and landed on his chest. They rushed him to the hospital. He wasn't expected to live. The church started praying for him. And he miraculously, unexplainably survived. He said, I'll tell you this. When I went back to my classroom to teach theology, I never taught it the same way. As a matter of fact, he said, I became known as the weeping professor on campus. All because of that incident. Before, I was up in the clouds. I knew all this information and theory. It was all theoretical information. But when that happened to me, I cried out to God, and he saved my life. And I could never be the same. Notice the final thing that Paul says here as he's winding this up. Relationships are important. Opportunities are important. But if you read 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, at the end of that chapter, Paul says, every time I sign off in one of my letters, you'll know it's genuinely from me. You want to know how? He always ends with the word grace. Paul wrote 14 letters in the New Testament. And every single one of them ends with this: grace be with you. And then he puts amen. And there's all kinds of definitions. I could ask a show of hands, how many of you have a definition of grace, and all kinds of definitions, and I get that. But I dug into this word this week and discovered that this is as literal as I can get it. It's God's unconditional loving kindness toward you. It's the old Hebrew hesed, unconditional love. It's what God did for Gomer through the husband Hosea. Hosea married a gal that went to the world to have her needs met from one man to another. And what did Hosea do? He went down to the place where she was being auctioned off and bought her back, and said, no matter what you've done in the past, all that's forgiven. You're my wife, and I love you, and I pity you, and I value you, and I'm taking you back to myself. That's what grace means. I don't want to belabor this, but I want to quickly go through the New Testament and show you what grace biblically is. Paul gave in chapter 2 of Philippians this incredible account how Christ humbled himself and went all the way to the cross of Calvary, and then God highly exalted him, gave him a name above every name. Remember that? The next verse says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Verse 13 says, because God is at work in your life to do two things. God's grace gives you a will that you never had before. God gives you a grace to want to go to church. God's grace gives you a grace to want to read the Bible. God gives you grace to want to make friends with those strange people called Christians, where before you didn't want to make friends with them. He gives you two things, the will, the desire, and the power to carry it out. Now, very quickly, you go through the New Testament. This is what grace is. Number one, it's given to all men. If you're here this morning, you've never bowed your knee to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, I can promise you he's knocking on your heart's door as I speak. And he wants to gain access into your spirit. Won't you repent of your sin and ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior? The grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared to how many people? All men. Teaching us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. Secondly, it's received freely. You can't earn this. There's not enough work you can do to save yourself. It's a gift. As a matter of fact, it's not of works. Otherwise, we could pat ourselves on the back and boast about it. So it's given to all. It's received freely. It's acquired little by little. We sometimes think that God just backs up and dumps out all kinds of grace on us all at once, and that's it, it's over with. No. 2 Peter chapter 3 says, I'm to grow in grace. How many of you have flowers on your front porch and you water those things? You go out and sing to them every morning, every evening, right? You know God gives you grace slowly. Increase, grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus. Notice who wrote this, by the way. If anyone ever had to grow in grace, it was Peter. And thank God Peter did grow in grace in the book of Acts. God really hauled off and used him. It can be resisted. Look diligently or carefully, lest any root of bitterness springs up and troubles you, and thereby many be defiled. It says, lest any man fails, come short of the grace of God. God wants to give you his grace, but you can say no to it. You can resist it. And it's only enjoyed by humble people. He gives greater grace. God resisteth the proud. Literally, that's like this big old offensive lineman lining up against a defensive lineman who's twice as big as him. How many of you want that job? God says, if you won't resist me, but if you'll humble yourself and come to me, I'll give you my grace. And finally, Jesus told a story about grace I want to end with. It's in Matthew chapter 18, because sometimes people miss definitions, but you can't miss this picture that Jesus paints in Matthew 18. One day, Peter came to Jesus and asked, how many times do I have to forgive my brother? How many times, Lord, do I have to forgive my brother? Seven times? And so Jesus understood Peter's heart, and he said, Peter, I want you to get this. I don't want you to miss it. So let me tell you a story. He said, one day there was a man who owed about, in our vernacular, our words today, about $200 million. It was impossible to pay back to his owner, to the master. So one day, the day of accountability came along, and this man had to pay up, but he didn't have that kind of money. So the Bible says he fell down and he worshiped, and he begged his master to have compassion on him. I can't pay this amount. Please have pity, have mercy upon me. And the Bible says that that master frankly forgave him the debt. What did the man do? He went across the street and he found his friend that owed him $20. And the Bible says he took him by the neck and he demanded that the man pay him $20. When word got out that this man who had been forgiven $200 million couldn't forgive his neighbor who only owed him $20, the Bible says his Lord got very angry, and he went to him, and he asked him a question. Why couldn't you forgive someone who owed you just a small amount, after you've been given such a great amount? Here's where it gets interesting. At the end of Matthew chapter 18, the Bible says that master of that servant went, took him, and he put him into a place where the Bible calls it at the end of Matthew chapter 18, a place where he would be tormented. And then he ends the chapter by saying, so likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you if from your heart you don't forgive everyone your brother their trespasses. Would you notice something? Didn't throw him in prison. He threw him into a place where he would be tormented. And if this morning there's someone that you've not been able to forgive, and you wonder why you're tormented, things that are in your life that you can't explain, you might want to look at that passage very carefully. And at the end of it, you might want to get on your knees and ask God to give you his grace. And you reach out by faith and take his grace so that you can come clean before God. What is it that God wants you to experience this morning? Number one, God wants you to experience strong relationships. What was important to the Apostle Paul? That you take advantage of your opportunities while you have them available to you. And make sure that you're walking in his grace. Let's bow our heads, shall we? With our heads bowed, our eyes are closed this morning, I wonder if there's someone here who needs to reach out by faith and receive God's grace. Have you really repented, that is, turned from your sin of saying no to Jesus Christ? Have you turned from that kind of living, resisting God's grace? And have you turned to him and asked for his mercy, his pardon, his forgiveness? And if you've not done that, this morning would be a good time and opportunity for you to do that. I'm going to go back in the back in a moment, get ready for baptism, but I'm asking Cameron to come and meet those who come forward during the invitation. If you need to trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I'd like to ask you to do that. Maybe you're here this morning and it never really dawned on you how important relationships are. Maybe you're at odds with someone. You've not really forgiven them. And God wants you to receive his grace in that area. Be set free from your tormentors. Maybe God has given you opportunities to do things. And you're waiting for a better season to do it. Paul's words to Timothy were spadazzo. Do thy diligence. Take advantage of the opportunity before there's no other opportunity. Then Paul told Timothy, take advantage of grace. Make sure you're walking in grace. Do you have the desire and the power to do what God wants you to do? If you've never experienced or received his grace, please don't leave this place this morning until you do that. Father, we love you. I'm just so honored to be able to give your word this morning because it just overwhelms me how relevant it is in our world today. It speaks to the deep needs in the recesses of our hearts. And I'm praying that if there's someone here this morning who doesn't know Christ, Lord, would this be the day of their salvation? That you'd put within them that desire to step out to the nearest aisle and come forward to inquire how I can know Jesus Christ personally. And I pray for the believers here this morning, Lord, help us to examine our hearts and make certain that these things that were valuable to the great Apostle Paul are as meaningful to us today. We love you and need you more than ever in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. If God's spoken to your heart, take advantage of this opportunity to come.
Yeah. this is Cadence Rosman, and I'm so thankful for Cadence. As I understand it, just recently she had a discussion with my wife, and she's basing what she's doing this morning on Romans chapter 2, verse 4. And I don't know if you've read that lately, but Romans chapter 2, verse 4 says that it is the goodness of God that leads us to repentance. And in Cadence's life, I remember recently praying for her because she, first of all, had some pretty traumatic surgery down in Columbus not long ago. And after that time, she had a pretty serious car accident. And God brought her through those things really, really well. And I think there's one or two other things that very personal to her that happened. And she just wants you to know that she's not despising the riches of God, but that through his goodness, she's been led to genuine repentance. So that's why she's here this morning. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. So, Cadence, if you wouldn't mind facing in that direction, based upon your profession of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ and out of obedience to his divine command, I'm now baptizing you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. You're now buried in baptism, and you are raised to walk in newness of life. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Amen. Well, let's stand together, shall we? Let's stand together. It doesn't get any better than that, I'll tell you. Father, we love you and just can't say thank you enough for your goodness in our lives. And I'm so thankful for the way that you've touched Cadence's life and how you brought her through these times and bouts of adversity. And as we're studying in the men's Sunday school class these days, that it often takes adversity for us to stop long enough and to look up and to listen to what you're saying to us. I pray from your word this morning that we would understand the things that are truly important. And like the great Apostle Paul, these things would be evident in our lives. Thank you for each one who's here today. We pray your richest blessing over each one as we go our different ways, that you'd make us a blessing to others. I pray for Cadence that you would truly use her life in very special ways for your great purposes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.